Good morning, church family. Welcome to Cornerstone. It's a great day to be in God's house together. Jesus, here we are. We're celebrating your goodness today, your faithfulness, declaring our trust and our confidence is in you, Jesus. Let's sing this out together. Blessed assurance. Blessed assurance. I know that Jesus is mine. Because he's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. I've been born of his spirit. I've been washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. So we say together, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, that's right, my Savior, the one who will never. Never fail. Thank you, Lord. Perfect submission. All is at rest. 'Cause I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. Thank you, Lord. So this is my story. And this is my song. I'll be praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will Jesus. You are our confidence. You are our hope. You've never failed and you won't start. So we say, I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord.
Yeah, this is our story.
And he heard and he answered.
He heard my cry.
I sought the Lord
and he heard
and he answered.
And that's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard.
I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord. my Savior. He will never fail. I trust in God.
We lift our hands to the heavens, and we are here for you. We reach for the hem of your garment. We know what it can do. We know what it can do. We refuse to go through the motions. When the King is in the room, hear the sound of our devotion. Let it build a throne for you. Let it build a throne for you. Let everything that has breath praise, praise. Let everything.
a thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Because your name is the highest. Because your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name, it stands above them all, above all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name, God, it stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever.
Yeah.
Oh, if you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing a song forever to the Lamb.
If you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing a song forever to the Lamb. We will sing a song forever and amen. And the angels cry, holy, all creation.
Sing it to Jesus. Oh, it stands above them all. Yeah, every voice, all thrones, all thrones. Your name, it stands above. Yeah, who's with us today? Come on. Jesus, your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name, it stands.
King of kings, holy,
Come on, church. Can we give God one more shout of praise this morning? So good. He is worthy. Amen. Amen. Church, you can grab a seat. Welcome to Cornerstone. We are so glad that you're here. If we haven't had the chance to meet, my name's Joel. I get to serve as our young adults pastor, working with our 18 to 29-year-olds. But I'm so glad that you're all here this morning. We say it all the time, but I hope you know that we never tire of worshiping Jesus with you week in and week out. So thanks for being here. If you're new with us, like if this is your first, second, maybe it's your fourth or fifth time, but you just haven't taken that first step to get connected, we want to invite you to do that. Our hope is that from the moment you stepped out of your car this morning in the parking lot, that you sense that God is doing incredible things here in and through our church. And so we want to invite you to not just see all that God is doing, but to be part of all that God is doing. So the easiest way to get connected and plugged into all that's going on here at Cornerstone is if you take out your phone right now and text the word new to 21999. Someone from our team will reach out, give you information and resources, help you get plugged in. We just want to help you get connected to all that's going on here at Cornerstone. Well, hey, in just a couple weeks, there's something that we know is coming, but we might not know how quickly it's coming. Easter weekend is just a few weeks away. And this is a big deal on the Christian calendar. We are going to celebrate that the God we worship sent his son Jesus to not just die for our sins, but he was raised from the grave. We worship a living God. And so Easter weekend is a huge weekend here at Cornerstone. We're going to have 12 identical services over the course of 3 days. So 12 services in this room starting on Friday, moving into Saturday, and then on Easter Sunday. So you have lots of options to choose from. And here's what we would ask. If you are part of the Cornerstone family, like if you're on the home team here at Cornerstone, would you and your family prayerfully consider joining us for one of the services on either Friday or Saturday? Because here's what we know. We know that God is going to bring thousands of people here on Easter Sunday who maybe don't have a church home. Maybe this is the one or two times a year that they step foot in a church. And so what we want to do is make it as easy as possible for them to encounter the living God on Easter Sunday by making room for them to come do that. So if that's you, that you're part of the Cornerstone family, would you just consider joining us on Friday or Saturday? Then the other way that you can help us serve those people is by letting us know which service you plan on coming to. So if you take out your phone, you can text Easter to 21999. That'll help us plan to serve you, but also to serve those new guests who will be with us on Easter Sunday. Right after Easter weekend, we're going to be moving into a series that we're really excited about. We're going to talk about all things dating, okay? All the single people in the room say amen. I love it. Hey, that's awesome. But hey, this is a series where, yes, we're going to talk about how to pursue a dating relationship in a way that honors God. But for all of the married people in the room, this is for you as well. We're going to talk about what does it look like to pursue and date your spouse, even in a marriage relationship. And so you will not want to miss it. The week after Easter, we're jumping into this series, and we're believing that God's going to move in a mighty way here. Church family, we brag all the time about how generous you are. The way that you give faithfully allows us to move forward all that God wants to do here locally and beyond. And so we want to say thank you. If you haven't yet taken that step of generosity, like if you haven't stepped into giving here at Cornerstone, we just want to put that opportunity in front of you. We believe that it not only blesses and moves forward what God wants to do practically, but it also blesses your heart. So to do that, you can start today by just texting the word give to 21999. Well, just a couple more things we want to share with you. Go ahead and take a look at these videos on the screen.
Good morning, Cornerstone Church. Here's what we do now. Wait. I'm John. I'm from Iowa. Last night, we were back here, and one of the stage managers, she says, where are you from? And I said, I'm from Iowa. And she goes, oh. You're supposed to go, really? But I'm from Prairie Lakes Church in Iowa. We have 7 sites. We're trying to make it really hard for people to miss Jesus in Iowa. And when we start our services, here's what I do. I say, hey, welcome to Prairie Lakes Church. I'm glad to be here. How about you? And you're supposed to go, yeah. Okay, ready? Hey, Cornerstone Church, I'm glad to be here. How about you? Very good. Thank you. We're really delighted to be here this weekend and to be able to be a part of this with you guys. And Lynn, your pastor, has been instrumental in my life over the years. Multiple times in my younger years as a pastor, I borrowed courage from him. One of the reasons that we're able to do what we do in Iowa is because of Lynn and some other significant leaders that have let us borrow courage from them. So thank you for being a church that allows your pastor to go around and do that. Really quickly, I've got a great wife. Her name is Kay. We have 3 grown children who are all married. We all live in the same city, Cedar Falls, Iowa, and we have 11 grandkids under 10 years old. Yeah. Yeah, in fact, here's a picture of them. There they are. I know. Just look at them for a minute, okay? Just look at that. I could tell you a story about each one of them. See that little redhead on the end over here, that little boy? His name is Cam. He's feral. Look at him. He's got red head. He got a long mullet that goes back down to here. He comes in the room and just throws stuff. But I don't got to raise them. Don't matter to me, you know? So we're going to talk about an area of our lives we need to change our approach on. Many years ago, my wife and I were finishing up a Christmas Eve service in Iowa. And my folks lived in Wyoming, which was 800 miles away across South Dakota. So you cross most of Iowa, you cross South Dakota, you get to Wyoming. So every year that would kind of be our track. And here's what we do. Our kids, you know, when they're little, it's horrible to take that long of a trip. So we'd leave at night. And I would drive all night. I would have like a six-pack of Mountain Dew, a full bag of sunflower seeds, literally a book on tape, if you know what I mean. Really was on tape. And we'd travel. We'd give our kids, you know, cough syrup with codeine. Those were the good years, okay? The good years. So we're there, and we did the same thing coming back. So one year we're coming back, and our kids are little. They're probably 7 and 5 and 3. I don't know, something like that. And we're coming back, and we're coming across South Dakota, and it's like January 2nd. And I don't know if you've ever been to South Dakota in the middle of the night on January 2nd. It's like being on the moon, okay? It's crazy. So we're coming back, and you know how in your life you've done stupid things, okay? And I've got like a pile of stupid things I've done, like a pile. And you know, when you relive those moments, it just brings up this like visceral gut reaction in you. This is one of those. We're coming back, it's like 2 or 3 in the morning, and we're gonna stop in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. There's this town called Mitchell, and then there's Sioux Falls that's 70 miles away or something like that. And I'm driving, everybody's sleeping, it's great, nobody's crying, it's great. And I'm thinking, I can make it to Sioux Falls because the little thing on my van, my minivan, said I have 79 miles to empty. I know, right? I know! Yes! It was wrong. And like 4 miles from Sioux Falls, man, we run out of gas. It's 3 a.m. It is whatever below zero. I've got 3 little kids in the car. I'm an idiot. My wife wakes up, and you know it's embarrassing. She goes, "What's happening?" I go, "I don't know." So I go, "We ran out of gas," and you know, you got to eat that, right? So I hop out of the car, right, just to meet. I just go, "Okay, we got to flag some down." So I hop out of the car right away, and I'm on the interstate. And there's like 4 people per every square mile in all of South Dakota, and less than that on the interstate. And trucks are coming by, and I'm like this, and they just like 6 or 7 of them, and it's cold out. And I'm like, my kids are in there. We're gonna be like fro. It's one of those moments. So like any godly man, I decided to change the approach. Okay. I get back in the car. I said to my wife, "Kay, you get out there and you try it, okay?" I'm not kidding you. First truck, right? I hop out with 3 kids. Thank you. Here's the point. Sometimes you got to change your approach to get different results, right? So this weekend we're going to talk about an area of life that most of us, right? Most of us need a change of approach on. Okay, now listen, don't like groan at me or like, "Oh, I came to church and he talked about this," but here's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about money. Okay, I'm not talking about giving. I'm just talking about money. It's the one thing that all of us have in common. Now. Here's what we're going to do. For the rest of the service, I want you to pull out money. If you have any money in your pocket, pull it out. Just hold it in your hand. Dollar bill, quarter, $10 bill. Leslie, I need you. Leslie, I need you. Okay, now listen. If you're like me and you don't come to church with money, look at this. So raise your hand. Honestly, this is real true now. Raise your hand if you don't have any money, because I want you to hold one the whole time. Raise your hand. They will get you some money, okay? Now listen, when I leave here, I want that all back, all right? Yeah, this guy, he wants 2. Give me 2 of them. All right, so if you don't have one, because I want you to hold it, okay? I want you to hold it. Now, here's the deal. Everybody, it affects all of us, and we all have it in common. We have to deal with it, fight with it, fight about it, fight over it, flirt with it, uses us. It brings some happiness, it brings some pain. And it has caused some of us to do some things we never thought we'd do. And it's put us in some places we never thought we'd be. This thing called money. This right here. It's the one thing that Jesus says, that has the power to affect every part of your being. Every part of your being. You don't believe me? Let's turn to a spot, and I'm gonna start with this, okay? If you have your Bible, turn to Matthew chapter 6, okay? Matthew chapter 6. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the four Gospels. Matthew 6 is 5, 6, and 7 are the Beatitudes. It's the first recorded sermon of Jesus. So he's hitting all the big stuff. And all of 5, 6, and 7 are really, hey, since Jesus has come, since this new kingdom has arrived, we have to change our approach and how we do a lot of things. And Jesus, in the Gospels, spends more time talking about this than he does heaven and hell combined. Because here's what he knows, that this has the power to alter every part of our being and put us in some spots that we never, ever imagined that we'd be in. So everybody get to Matthew chapter 6. Now, in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus starts with this. This is in the, it's in the context of fasting and then anxiousness, right? Two big things. So he says in verse 19, he says, so do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. And here's verse 21. Here's the kicker. Of all the things that Jesus could talk about, right? Sacks or whatever he could say right here about money, here's what he says. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So Jesus says, this is the thing. This is the one thing that has the ability to capture your heart. The inside stuff. To change the course and direction of how you view the world and how you view yourself. This is it. This has the power to do that. Jesus says it. And then he's going to end it talking about money. But in between this verse 21, for where your treasures there your heart will be also, and then the end where he brings it back, he says this. And it's kind of confusing, but put it in the context. He says, the eye is the lamp of the body. And if your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light, right? What comes in will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then within you, if then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? So Jesus now, he makes this shift and he says, listen, what's in you, what happens inside of here is the issue. It's the key. And then he comes back and he says this, no one can serve two masters. Either you'll hate the one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. And then he says, you cannot serve both God and money. Now, friends, listen, I know this is, seems weird, right? But Jesus says, this is the one thing. This is the one thing that can mess you up physically, emotionally, relationally, and spiritually. This is the one thing that can do it. In fact, later in the New Testament, in 1 Timothy, Paul the Apostle, and 1 Timothy is literally, he's writing a letter to this guy named Timothy who's a new pastor, and he's saying, hey, here's the tips and instructions I have for you as a young new pastor. And in chapter 6, verses 9 to 10, he says this. He says, those who want to get rich fall into a temptation, a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires. And listen to how he describes it, that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money, when it's in the wrong place, right? When this gets the wrong spot in your heart, and when this becomes more important than most things, when this determines how you feel about yourself and how to feel about your future and how you feel about your past, when this gets in the wrong spot, he says this, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Now listen, I'm the risk of overstating, I'm going to tell you right now that I'm not, because Jesus is the one who said those words about where your heart is, and you can only serve God or this. And Paul's the one who wrote most of the New Testament. Paul's the one who said this one has the ability to do some crazy stuff in you and with you. So my friends, listen, if you want different results, you got to change your approach. And most of us are due for a change of approach, because this is the one thing, this is the one thing that has the potential to take you places you never thought you'd be. So here's where we're going to be. We're spending the rest of our time in two passages, okay? So the first one is Luke 15. So if you have your Bible, turn to that. Use your phone. The Bible app is a really good one. But get to Luke 15. And Luke 15 is in the middle of a batch of parables that Luke's recording that Jesus wrote. And Luke 15 is really, it's like my spot. I love Luke 15. Because it's all about what the Father's like, what the Father's like. And then telling the story of what the Father's like, of course, telling the story of what the Father's like, this is going to be impacting on how we view the Father, how we live this life on earth. So Luke 15 is the story of the parable of the lost sheep, right? And then it's the parable of the lost coin. And then most of us are familiar with the story of the prodigal son. But it's the story, the parable of not just one lost son, but there's actually two sons in this story. And they're both equally lost. And both of them are centered around this. This is what causes them to be in some spots, okay? So let's start with this. I'm going to start with the first son, and we're going to make this statement. Here's what money can do if you don't change your approach. It can take you to a place that's simply not okay. It can do it. It can take you to a place that simply is not okay. So I'm going to go to the text, and you follow along with me, and I'll stop and do some stuff, okay? So Jesus continued, it says in verse 11, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. And that sounds weird, right? It sounds weird. And you're thinking, well, maybe it's just a cultural thing. Maybe, nope. Just as weird today as it would have been 2,000 years ago. In other words, the younger son is saying, hey, you got a lot of stuff. I want mine now. In other words, I can't wait until you die, Dad. So give me my money. And we don't know why. We don't know the whole story around this thing. But for some reason, the father acquiesces. The shame that he brought on his own family, the shame that his own son brought on him, he acquiesces. And so here's what he does. So he divided his property between them. Verse 13 says, not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. So my friends, just for a minute, let's stop on this one, okay? Money and our desire for it and our approach to it is the one thing. It's the one thing, Jesus says, that can take you to a place that's just not okay. Now, for a lot of us, right, I have my past. I have my pre-Jesus football playing, beer drinking, pot smoking, girl chasing days. I've got that. And some of you have that kind of a past and a background that you found yourself in. But listen to this. Jesus in this story says, if you don't change your approach to this, if this doesn't get the proper place in your life, not as king, not as the high point. And here's what it's going to do. It will literally take you to places that are not okay. Some of you know that right now. Some of you have gambled this away and lost your families. Some of you have compromised your integrity and ended up in a place that just wasn't okay. Some of us have been so inappropriate with this, that our approach to this was so off that it's caused our families all kinds of pain. Jesus says, this is the one thing that can do it. And if you don't change your approach to this, Jesus says, here's what's going to happen. It's going to take you to a place that's just not okay. And he tells what happens to this son, what happens to him. And he finally, in verse 17, he says, and when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I have nothing. I'm starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. And here's the beautiful part. This is the beautiful part. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, was filled with compassion for him, ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. He had a dad who, no matter how far he'd fallen, no matter how low he'd dropped, how many stupid things he's done, he had a dad who still loved him. And he walked away from that dad. Why? Because of this. This caused him to get to a place that he walked away and shamed his family. And ended up in a spot he just never, ever, ever thought he'd be. This has the power to do that. So the story goes, and this is the picture of the father, right? Here he is. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Quick! Bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is now found. So they began to celebrate. This put the younger son in a spot that wasn't okay. He walked away from his family. He walked away from a loving father. He shamed them all. Why? Because this is what he wanted most. This is it. Now, the story doesn't end there. And in fact, it takes another turn. And this time, it takes us to a place that only money can do. It can keep you longer than you wanted to stay. Okay? It can. Not only can it put you in a place you never thought you'd be, but it can put you, take you longer than you wanted to stay. So here's what happens next. Verse 23 says this, Meanwhile, the older son was in the field, and when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of his servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. And then there's this one sentence that's easy to miss. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. He became angry and he refused. His brother, who was lost and broken and at the bottom of the barrel, comes crawling back home, and this father that he knows, his father, welcomes him home. But the brother says, and catch this, but he answered his father, Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, not my brother, but when this son of yours, and look, this is the issue, has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. You see, that first brother was really lost, wasn't he? He had this in the wrong place, and the wrong place him took to a thought place he'd never thought he'd be. And that knuckle-headed younger brother was just as lost as the straight-laced older brother. You see, that straight-laced older brother had the same problem. He didn't give a care that his brother came home. All he cared was he took something that was supposed to be his. And the end of the story, it never resolves. The younger brother, it resolves. He comes home and he's repentant and we assume he's got it figured out, right? The older brother's story never resolves at the end. All we know from him is this. He refused to go in. He refused it. We know how long it lasted. We have no resolution of the story. But what we know is this. That this kept that older brother longer in a place than he wanted to stay, longer than he ever thought he'd stay. He emotionally closed in. I'm not going in there. Your son of yours did this. Bitterness set in, envy set in, anger set in. We don't know how long it lasted, but what we do know is this, that today, maybe not you, maybe someone in your family is emotionally broken, relationally detached because of their approach to this. I know people who haven't spoken to their siblings in over 30 years because when mom and dad passed, they didn't think they got a fair shake in the inheritance. For 30 years, it kept them in a place longer than they ever thought they'd stay. You see, Jesus talks so much about this because what he knows is this is the one thing that has the ability to affect you in all areas, physically and relationally and emotionally. But there's one more area. And this area is the one that Paul spoke about a little bit when he said, some of people have wandered from the faith because of their love for this. We're going to put on Easter, and the primary piece to the Easter story, the Good Friday story, is the story of Judas. So Jesus is with the disciples at the Last Supper. You guys will be talking about that. And Jesus is, one of you are going to betray me. And you know how the story goes, or most of us do. And Judas ends up betraying him. And what we know about Judas is that he literally let this affect him spiritually and eternally, because this was in the wrong place. The text says this. It says, when Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse, not repentance, and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. I've sinned, he said, for I betrayed innocent blood. And they replied, what is that to us? That's your responsibility. So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. And then he went away and hanged himself. And did all that for this. All that for this. And in the end, what he betrayed Jesus for, I'm not going to throw this. No way. 30 pieces of silver. Jesus says, here's what money can do if you don't change your approach. It can take you to a place that's not okay. It can keep you longer than you wanted to stay. And if you don't get a fix, it's going to cost you more than you'd ever thought you'd be willing to pay. So, my friends, here's the issue as we head into Easter. This is actually a spiritual issue. And it's time that we have a different approach and we change it. This needs to change. How you think about this, how you view this, how you handle this, what you do with this and what it does to you needs a new approach. It does. So every one of us would say, oh, I'd never find myself in a bad spot. And there we are. Every one of us say, well, I'd never sin. And every one of us does. This is one of the things that we have to change our approach to. Let's go to one more passage. We're going to close with this, okay? One more passage. I want you to turn to John chapter 11, okay? So Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, go to chapter 11. In John chapter 11 is the entire chapter is devoted to the death of Lazarus, okay? Now, Lazarus was actually a friend of Jesus. He was actually a friend of his. And this is Mary and Martha. There's several instances where he goes to their home, and Jesus is there. He's there actually friends with them. But Lazarus, in chapter 11, Lazarus dies, and the whole first 3/4 of the chapter are all about what happens. And I want you to dig into that this week and read about what happens. But when in 32 it says, when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. And when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. And verse 35 is, Jesus wept. He wept. Then you go down farther in the story, and Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor. King James says, he stinketh. For he's been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you'll see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And in verse 43, it says this. And we had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice. Now this is just crazy, right? The stone is rolled away. He's been dead 4 days. And he says, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And that'd be the best place ever, right, for a mic drop. Boom. Story's over. I mean, he came out, right? There was nothing else to say about this story, but the story's not over. There's one more sentence. One more sentence. At the very end, Jesus says, take off the grave clothes and let him go. He had new life. He was dead, and now he was alive. But there was still some unwrapping to do. There were still some things that needed to be unwrapped and dealt with. And my friends, in our day, you may have new life in Christ, but you've never been free from this. And if you will keep this in its proper place, instead of in the improper first place, if you move this from the one thing that makes you happy or makes you sad, the one thing that gives you assurance about the future or dread about the future, if you move this from that place and put Jesus in that place, you'll be free. You will be free. So here's what I want us to do. Everybody, everybody hold your money now, okay? Hold it. Keep it in your hand. We're going to have just a short time of prayer together, and we're going to walk down 3 areas, okay? In fact, here's what I really like you to do is look at it. Not longingly, okay? My precious. Maybe for you, this is an area of obedience. And you just need to unwrap the control that you just feel like you have. And this is yours, this is mine, this is mine, this is mine. It's really not. It's the Creator who gave it to you. Maybe it's an area of submission, or you just need to unwrap the pride. Too many of us let this define us. I'm only somebody or something, or only be somebody or something if I got enough of this. But for some of us, it's literally just, we need to unwrap the sin. We have just sinned. So let's bow our heads. Let's hold your money. Father, we come before you and we know that you love us deeply. You're the Father who runs to the broken and the messed up and welcomes us home. God, there's a lot of us that just aren't free. We've let this thing you warned us about, take too much control, have too high of a place. So here's what we ask, that you would do what you need to do in each of us, whether it's control or pride or sin, obedience or submission. We just say, God, would you please? We want to be free. Our hope and our joy rests in one thing, Father. And it's this Jesus that you sent defeated death on the cross, death and sin, and rose again. And he's going to come again someday. And for those of us who follow him, he's going to take us home. Your glory is all that matters. So God, we give this to you, this thing, this money. And we say you're first and nothing else. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody said, amen. All right, family. You got a couple weeks till Easter. Get a friend on your arm. Okay, come sit with me is your phrase. If you want prayer, we have some prayer teams down front. Otherwise, have a great week. Oh, give me my money back, too. I got two more services with this. I only got one pile. Bless you.